Psalm 63. O God, you are my God, earnestly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you, my body longs for you, in dry and weary land. There is no water. I have seen you in the sanctuary and beheld your power and your glory. Because your love is better than life, my lips will glorify you. I will praise you as long as I live. And in your name I will lift up my hands. My soul will be satisfied with the riches of food. With singing lips, my mouth will praise you. On my bed I remember you. I think of you through the watches of the night, because you are my help. I sing in the shadow of your wings. My soul clings to you. Your right hand uphold me. They who seek my life will be destroyed. They will go down to the depths of the earth. They will be given over to the sword and become a food for the jackals. But the king will rejoice in God. Who will swear by God's name will praise him. While the mouths of the liars will be silenced. It's a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful psalm. It is written by David, and David is in a very difficult place. He finds himself in the wilderness of Judah. Some of the commentators have different views about what had happened at this time, but there are three main things that are quite critical for us to understand the context of the psalm and where David was at this point. It is either one, that David was in the wilderness years before he ascended the throne of Israel. The second thing is that it was during his brief exile. I wonder whether you remember that painful story where he was chased out of Jerusalem by his son Absalom, and because he waged a rebellion against his father. And the third is that this might have been during the time when King Saul had chased David into the wilderness because he wanted to kill him. He wanted David to be killed. He saw David as a threat to his kingdom. So commentators will go with this as three different views, but it seems that the one that has a very strong pull is during the time of the wilderness when King Saul was trying to kill him. And so David finds himself in the wilderness. And a wilderness is a place of pain, a place of suffering. It's a place where there is no life. And he is in the wilderness. He finds himself in a place where there is a deep thirst in his life, because there is no water in the wilderness. There is no source of life that he can derive in that situation. So the Bible says that David was thirsty. He longed for water to quench this thirst. I like the Greek word that is used often in the Bible to describe thirst. It is called dipsos. And dipsos as a word that English uses today, the word dipsomaniac. And dipsomaniac, or it's a person, dipsomania, it's the state of extreme thirst that we have. And sometimes it will describe a person's craving for alcoholic beverages. But it means that there is a deep thirst in a person, a thirst that bring dryness in the mouth and the throat because there are lack of fluids. And we have used the word thirst to talk about either one is a thirsty for knowledge or thirsty for wealth, thirsty for enjoyment, so that it expresses a deep longing in a person to have something in your life to enable you to move. And for David, here the thirst is realizing that he thirsts for God. He longs for God. He longed to experience the love of God in his life when he finds himself in this terrible place. He longs to know that God cares, that God understands his plight, that God understands his pain, his disappointment, that God is able to see that he has been persecuted by people that he thought will be instruments and the conduits of the love of God in his life. He realized that he has been let down big time and find himself in this horrible place. And so he expresses this deep thirst for touch of God. When we read Psalm 42, let me read Psalm 42 for you, because for me, Psalm 42 will express this quite beautifully. As the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. Where can I go and meet with my God? My tears have been my food day and night, while men say to me all day long, where is your God? Where is your God in this suffering and pain? Why is he leaving you? Why is he deserting you? Why is he throwing you under a bus? Where is your God? And so he come to the realization that, but there is more about the love that God has for me. That God cares deeply for me. You know, when you have a picture of a deer, I have a picture that it is running all over the place in the hills of Judah, because the hunters are chasing after it. And it has run and it is now exhausted and come to a place where there is water, and they see this deer sea life. It's that longing for God, longing for his presence, longing for his company, longing for him to hold us. And David realizes that, but my God is an amazing God, is a loving God. It's a God who will fight my battles against my enemies. It's a Lord who has a vengeance and look at my situation and understand that situation. And David realizes that there is no place that is safe than in being in the Lord, that the Lord will keep him safe. The Lord will cover him. The Lord will throw a hedge around him so that he is protected. And then he praises him. He says that there is nothing that can flow out of my heart except praise for the Lord, because the Lord is loving, is caring. The Lord is on my side. The Lord walks with me. The Lord keeps me company. The Lord is not far from me. The Lord is holding me. David drinks from the water of life. The water that brings renewal, the water that brings restoration, the water that connects us to the love of God, to the source of who we are. As we read in the Gospel according to John chapter 4, Jesus make reference to this amazing water that bring life. And just before we go into a time of prayer, listen to what he says. It's that story of the Samaritan woman that was in conversation with Jesus. And as they were talking, she expresses a longing for the water that Jesus offers. And as she expresses her need for this, Jesus answered her and said, "Everyone who drinks this water, that water from the well, will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the water I give him will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give to him will become in him a spring of water welling to eternal life." It will come deep inside this person, and it is water that will well to eternal life. I wonder whether you remember the story in Ezekiel 47. I understand this water, because in Ezekiel it is put so beautifully. Ezekiel 47 has the Lord allow Ezekiel to see this amazing river that comes out of the temple, out of the middle of the temple. And it said that this river was flowing to a place in the direction of Siloam. And in this, he is able to see what this river will do in places where it will flow. Because this river will bring life. This river will bring restoration. And the Lord has taken Ezekiel into different, you know, the water was knee deep, was covered and came to his knees, and now it was flowing, almost covering his whole body. And then in verse 7 we read, Ezekiel 47, "When I arrived there, I saw the great number of trees." Now it is where this river comes, where this all this water have flown. "And I saw a great number of trees on each side." This river beginning to bring life. "He said to me, 'This water flows toward the eastern region and goes down into Araba, where it enters the sea. When it empties into the sea, the water there becomes fresh. Swarm of living creatures will live wherever the river flows. There will be large number of fish because this water flows there and make the salt water fresh. So where the river flows, everything will live. Fishermen will stand along the shore from the Engedi to En Eglaim. There will be places for the spreading nets. The fish will be of many kinds, the fish of the great sea. But swamps and marshes will become fresh. There will be left for salt. Fruit trees of all kinds will grow on both banks of the river. Their leaves will not wither, nor will their fruit fail. Every month they will bear, because the water from the sanctuary flows to them. Their fruit will serve for the food, and their leaves for the healing." It brings life. So I want to encourage you, as we are living through this difficult time, when There is so much cry in the world. Wherever we look, there are threats of devastation in lives of people, in the well-being of societies. Jobs are threatened. Economy is struggling. And not only in South Africa, but economies in the world. The people are unhappy. There is so much uncertainty. But in the midst of all that, there is so much hope, because we can see how God is penetrating into those deep, deep places to bring the resurrection and newness and hope. And as we approach at this time of prayer, I am so conscious, and I know you too, of the need for God to quench the thirst that is in the world. The thirst that is in my life and in your life. The thirst that is in all people for God's intervention and for God to lead us. Let us pray. Father, we approach your throne of grace. And we declare that you are our Lord, our God, the Father of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And Father, as we come into this time of prayer, we are so conscious of how the Holy Spirit is holding us, strengthening us, enabling us to weather the storm as we move through this time. A time of uncertainty, but a time of hope. A time, Father, where you begin to push the deadness of life, because you want to bring renewal and restoration and hope. So, Father, we come before your throne, certain of your love for us, certain that we are your children, certain of the place that we occupy in the kingdom. Certain, Father, of the promise that we are heirs in the kingdom. And not only that we are heirs, we are co-heirs with Jesus Christ. So that whatever portion that you have designated for your Son, Jesus Christ, we too are included in that. Thank you, Father, for this amazing love, this amazing care that you have for each and every one of us. That you have loved the world so much, that you have given your only Son, so that whoever believes in him, whoever gives their lives to him, they will never perish, will have eternal life. And so, Father, we are very conscious of the huge promise that you have put on us, that we are never alone. We never walk this path by ourselves. That you are by our side, you are holding our hands, and whatever we are going through, you are holding us because you are going through that with us. We are going through that experience with you. And so, Father, we are mindful of the needs in the world. We think of people who who are not well, people who are battling with their health. Last week, Father, we left someone within our midst who had cancer and just wanting to pray, Father, for people who are suffering with cancer.